you, what sort of deficit you reckon today?
Bloody big one. I don't know the actual number, but I think we're heading towards 40 to 50% of GDP in terms of debt. And I think one of the important things we want to see today is, yep, we all understand that this is the reality, but we need to see something that says, well, how are we going to get back into some sort of balance over the next several years? And so you will see it blowing up very big this year, but you'd expect to see a path back to some sort of recovery after that.
Over what number of years do you think?
Well, the public will ultimately have to judge that. It took a fair while after the GFC, but don't forget that was the GFC and the Canterbury earthquakes together. Effectively, there was a start back, and then there was the earthquakes, which had another impact. Those two together blew debt out to 30% of GDP. And all that really says is how hard it is to pay it back once you get to sort of 30, 40% of the size of the economy. And we all know after we got to that point of 30% GDP, it was a hard grind back. A lot of people were critical about the costs, basically how tight the government had to be over that period. But actually, that's what happens when you blow out to large amounts of debt.
Last time we had you on the program, you said you wouldn't want to go past 40. If it's 50, is that mean the government has spent too much, or we underestimated the size of the problem, or fiscally they don't really know what they're doing?
I think you've just got to look at the numbers today. I mean, this is really our first chance to see the damage, and it will be substantial. And we all know that this will not be the final answer either. It's just the best stab in the dark from Treasury, frankly, at this point. Now, they'll be doing their best, and they've got some good people there, but fundamentally, they don't know a lot of things that the rest of us don't know. And that's things like how much what's been happening overseas will impact on the New Zealand economy and demand for our goods. It hasn't happened yet, but it's bound to happen at some point. They'll be trying to work out how people will change their behaviours post-COVID. Now, is everybody going to rush straight back in to do what they used to do? Probably not, maybe for the first week, but we'll be still coming from level 4 to level 3 is that there was an initial rush back to buy a takeaway coffee and then it all slowed down again. So those sorts of questions aren't able to be answered yet. They'll do their best estimate. In terms of whether the government should go to 40 or 50, I think it really depends on what they're spending it on. They have to support the businesses that have been flattened by this thing more. I would expect to see that today. And when I say the ones flattened, I don't mean 30% drop in turnover. I mean the ones that we've all heard about, the 70, 80, 90% drop in turnover. Those are the ones that really need support beyond next week. At the moment, it starts to run out next week, and it's a significant... we could end up tearing up a whole lot of New Zealand's economic infrastructure, all the small businesses and so on, unless there's real support there. And then you have to look at what they're going to do to stimulate the economy. And that's challenging because a lot of people, if you gave them money in their pockets right now, would probably just stick it in the bank.
Exactly.
So they have to be careful there. And I would argue the test has to be, are you backing small and medium-sized businesses and families to succeed? If anything is being done in that area targets that, then I think that's positive. If we're still spraying money in absolutely every direction, I think that's probably going to be money that we'll regret later because we won't have anything else in the locker to do other things that we might need to do. I mean, this thing's going to run a long time. If you look at over in Australia, they think they're going to peak at 10% unemployment and they won't be back to 7.5% until the end of next year. So this thing, the same thing's going to apply in New Zealand, or whether it's the exact same numbers. I think the Reserve Bank here thinks 9%, but it's going to be of that order of magnitude, and that means you're going to have to be in for the next 2 years, not just what actually is going to happen in the next 5 minutes.
Separate but related, what do you make of Winston in China, and how reliant do we need to be, should we be, on a place like that, which is out the other side and with a lot of money ready to spend?
Well, I think we are more dependent on China than we were before, whether we'd like to be or not, because China is, as you say, recovering more quickly because they went in earlier, and we all know the history of that. So we are going to have to, they are our largest trading partner. They're Australia's largest trading partner. And Australia is our second largest trading partner. The uncomfortable reality for both New Zealand and Australia is you know, there's some many things about China that, you know, people don't like, and it's entirely understandable. But they're also hugely important to the world economy and world demand. So just in the same way that we don't go around giving the US a smack on the nose every 5 minutes, we can't do the same for China either. So we've got to be, you know, just diplomatic and sensible about these things for our own good, not because we have any particular desire to cuddle up to any of these large countries. But, you know, New Zealand, we're a small player. We have to recognise that, and we have to do sensible things from our perspective while also hanging on to our principles. It's not easy.
On the politics of it, and this will eventually become political, is there room for your party to go, this is wrong, it's a mistake, and here's our plan, and we could do it better? Or is this just such a big mess, no one's going to blame anybody?
It'll be a mixture of both, because there are legitimate choices to be made over how you stimulate the economy and how you build back. And some of the rhetoric coming out of the government suggests they want to change the world through this process. I would argue, rather than doing that from a philosophical perspective, you should be doing that from a, well, what's changing and therefore what we need to do. And I think consumer demand is much more important than what any politician in Wellington thinks. And so what are the consumers doing? So yes, they'll do more after this. They'll probably do more stuff online. They'll probably do less travel, a bit less commuting. But these are all trends that were happening anyway. They'll just accelerate those trends. But if you see politicians coming up and saying, you know, we want to completely remake the world, well, it's an understandable human sentiment, but it doesn't actually help, because you've got enough worries for people who are trying to invest their money and make a dollar in a business, you know, in a small business, without them sitting there thinking, oh, there's a bunch of politicians that now want to take out a black marker and rearrange the whole world. So the politics of it, I think, is it's really important that the government doesn't look political today and doesn't do things that are obviously political. Yes, there's an election coming up in 3 months' time, but they have been given, rightly by the public, a lot of latitude through this, because it's sort of a bit above politics. So if they turn around and start being political in terms of the way they allocate funding, you know, big money for the Greens or big money for New Zealand First, which doesn't look like it's the thing that's absolutely necessarily needed, then I think they'll get the same sort of backlash that, you know, that the opposition has struck from time to time, because you know, people don't have much tolerance for that. If this is a huge problem and we're going into massive debt, then there won't be much tolerance for, you know, big boondoggles for coalition partners.
Appreciate your time as always, Stephen Joyce, former finance minister.